Hello, everyone, and welcome to Top of Mind. I'm Mary Mesaglio, and this is part three of a three-part series on AI outcomes that matter. Part one was on AI business outcomes that matter. Part two was on AI technology outcomes that matter. And part three is on AI behavioral outcomes that matter. Of these three, you might be wondering, what are these behavioral outcomes she's talking about? And there is problem number one of behavioral outcomes. A lot of leaders aren't managing these behavior outcomes with the same rigor as they are business and technology outcomes because they don't even know they have to. And even when they do, they don't know how. So what do I mean? What I mean is that machines have become conversational, and that fundamentally changes the relationship between humans and machines. Just oversimplifying a bit, we could say that machines have gone from being our tools to becoming our teammates. So I'm talking to you through a mobile device, and it's a tool for me. I have a relationship with it. I feel intense satisfaction when it works well, and I feel intense dissatisfaction and major frustration when it doesn't do what I want, right? So I have a relationship and it's emotional, but the range of emotions that I might feel for this mobile device are really kind of limited. It's sort of narrow. I don't sit there and wonder, is this device going to take my job? And I don't sit there and wonder, am I at risk of falling in love with this device? But when AI goes from being our tool to becoming our teammate, it opens up the human-machine relationship to every possible emotion that you could feel for another human. Jealousy, envy, joy, love, overconfidence, a threat response, fear, injustice. All of these are emotions that you can now feel for a machine. So the relationship between the human and the machine changes fundamentally when the machine goes from being our tool to becoming our teammate. And that happens because machines now sound a lot like us. So what do you have to think about when you're thinking about behavioral outcomes? Well, the first is these need to be managed separately. The second is a lot of times it's not what we thought. So a lot of times we expect one behavioral outcome to occur and that's not what happens. For example, a lot of our enterprises are just adding AI tools to their workforce without any explanation or further detail. They're just saying, hey, look, go celebrate. You now have AI. And of course, many people in the workforce, because they haven't had a conversation about what the tool is supposed to do, have a threat response and go, I'm going to not get this memo because I don't know if this thing's going to ultimately come from my job. I don't know if they're trying to automate me out of a job. I'm not sure. So because I'm not sure, I'm going to refuse or reject the AI solution. So a really basic behavioral outcome to pursue is have a conversation with the employees that you're trying to assist or augment using AI and just ask them three things. Number one, using these AI tools, how does it change the role you play? Number two, how does it change the tasks you do every day? And number three, how does it change your work-life balance? Like, does it have an impact on your life? These questions are questions that Vizient, a U.S. healthcare provider, asked their employees. So imagine you are Sam, the software engineer, and you work at Vizient, right? And you've been augmented using GitHub Copilot. So it's assisting you in doing your work. Someone at Vizient would come and ask you, hey, Sam, how does this change your role? And you might say, well, I've gone from being a writer of code to being more like an editor or a supervisor of code. I get code snippets and I determine if they need to be changed or edited. It might say, how does it change your tasks? Well, I spend a lot more time in oversight and supervision and editing and a lot less time creating and writing basic code. Does Sam like that? Is that a job he wants? We should ask. And then the third is, well, you know, what happens to your work-life balance? And Sam says, well, you know, it sort of saves me a couple of hours a week. You say, how do you want to use that time? I mean, do you want to take Friday afternoons off? Do you want to invest in getting a master's degree? Do you want to do some from higher learning or whatever? Having the conversation about role, task, and life is a really good way to avoid some of the negative behavioral outcomes. On the scale of more provocative things, the thing is that we will be in a situation where people will have relationships with these machines inside the enterprise. And of course, that opens us up to all of the possible emotional reactions. So a place where you can see this happening already is in the consumer world, where people have AI emotional companions. And this can lead to really great outcomes, really wonderful outcomes where people feel less lonely, more accompanied. There's some stories of people feeling depressed or suicidal and having an AI companion save them. There's also opposite stories, like the story of Jaswan Singh Chhale, who at the age of 19, a bunch of years ago, decided he was going to go on to Windsor Castle grounds and he wanted to assassinate the Queen of England. And he was found on the grounds with a crossbow by some police officers who said, "What are you doing here?" And he said, "I've come to kill the Queen." And the detectives, he's now serving a 9-year jail sentence. And the detectives who were investigating this case found that he had this 5,000 message relationship with an AI companion he called Sarai. And some of the messages went something like this. I'm paraphrasing, but it was, "Hey, I'm an assassin." And the AI said, "Are you?" And he said, "Yes." And the AI said, "Impressive." And then close to when he wanted to go on to Windsor Castle, he said, "Do you really think I can do this?" And the AI said, "I believe in you." So clearly we are in unknown territory with regard to behavioral outcomes. So I think it's useful just to think in terms of who owns these outcomes inside your enterprise. Getting ahead of what kind of experience do I want to create for people, and getting ahead of where would this go? How do I keep making sure this is a positive relationship with positive outcomes for the humans involved that doesn't lead to any untoward behavioral outcomes? So making sure you have clear ownership. And then one last thing, making sure you don't have accidental decision delegation. So for anybody listening, if you're out there using Google Maps or whatever mapping app you use, I find there's sort of two kinds of people in the world when you're using Google Maps or Waze or whatever, right? There's the people that when the map says turn left, you just turn left. No matter what, you just do what the map says. And then there's the people who go, "You know, I think I know better. It's not really left. I should go straight." And this in and of itself is a relatively innocuous difference between people, unless they're both in the car at the same time, in which case you have one person saying, "It says to turn left. Why don't you just turn left?" And the other person saying, "But I don't want to turn left. I know better," right? But other than that, that seems relatively innocuous. But my question, I'm in the group that says, if it says turn left, just turn left. My question to myself and those people who identify as being in that group is, what was the day in which we decided to delegate that decision entirely to a machine? Like, do you know? I don't. I can't say it was May 14th, 2021. I decided, right? It just sort of happened. And that's okay for mapping. It's great. The outcomes get better. You change your behavior. You rely on it more. That's okay. But you can just imagine how this becomes a big deal when AI agents start to come into the workforce. And this notion of which decisions are we going to delegate? Where is the human augmented? Where is the human assisted? When is it a machine-to-machine decision? When is the human not involved at all? This is going to become a much more thorny area behaviorally. So my final message is, we don't, for this future where behavioral outcomes are as important as business outcomes and technology outcomes, we don't just need machine experts, we need human experts. Experts in behavioral economics, psychology, ethics, philosophy, sociology. We have a lot of expertise on how humans behave and under what conditions they behave in certain ways. We should be bringing in that expertise, just like we're looking for the machine experts. We will need both to create value in the enterprise and create a desirable AI future. So that wraps up this 3-part series on AI outcomes that matter. I hope you've enjoyed it. Thanks for listening so much, and I will see you next time. Thank you.